Okay, good morning.
Because we have two more speakers after this.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lalit Verma, for this opportunity. I'll basically be showing only illustrative cases, no didactics. So posterior uveitis has been classified by the International Uveitis Study Group as choroiditis or chorioretinitis or retinochoroiditis, retinal vasculitis, neuroretinitis. So choroiditis typically has no pain. It's a painless sudden vision loss. Patient comes like this, usually bilateral. You see the lumpy, bumpy choroid. And if you do an angiogram, there are almost no findings, though you may have hyperfluorescence of the optic nerve head because of the inflammation. And with steroids, typically responds extremely well. So this is another relatively young person who came with sudden vision loss. And we thought looking at the OCT could be CSCR. But angiogram was not suggestive of CSCR. And so we took the chance and gave steroids. Be very careful, if it is CSCR, it will get worse with steroids. So it should be clear that it is not CSCR. And also once you have treated, you have to be vigilant even in coming several months to years, because you can see the reactivation happening at the lower edge of the scars. So this is a young man who came with sudden further drop. Be vigilant and tell the patients to keep steroids at home, high dose steroids, take it if there is a drop in vision. This is a patient who was being treated for left eye choroiditis, and then 3 months after we stopped steroids, the other eye started. And even while we were treating this lesion, there was another lesion temporal to the macula, even while he's on steroids. So we increased the dose again, and we could manage to save his fovea, at least in this eye. But sometimes, even while the patient is being treated with steroids, they continue to worsen. And this case, we knew that this is probably not the regular choroiditis, not the immune variety. And though the skin test was negative for TB, gold was positive, we treated her with anti-TB, and you see the beautiful resolution. So many times, even if the skin test is negative, you can still give TB treatment if your steroids are not working on the choroiditis and you suspect it clinically. This is a young boy, very young, 18, 19 years old, and came with retinitis. Everything was negative. Skin test was borderline positive, 10 mm, we ignored it. And because it was retinitis, we treated it as toxoplasma, no response, lot of steroids, IV steroids. He continued to worsen. Finally, we gave him anti-TB therapy, and you see the beautiful resolution, which was not happening for almost 5 to 6 months otherwise. This is a young boy, young man again, came with right eye involvement, and we gave him steroids thinking it's the regular choroiditis. After 6 months also, the resolution was not too good, but anyway, stopped steroids after 6 months, and within 2 weeks of stopping, there were new lesions. So now I knew I had to do a skin test, and it was strong, it was 13 mm, but all other tests were negative. Gave him ATT, and you see, within 10 days, the resolution was better. But you can continue to get new lesions even while the patient is on ATT for several weeks. So not to dishearten that the ATT is not working. At the beautiful resolution you get with ATT when it is indicated. Sometimes you can use biologics if a patient is not able to tolerate systemic steroids, like we did in this young man. Left eye was already damaged with choroiditis, and now he came with other eye involvement. There were few patches, if you can see, inferior to the fovea, and now we panicked because he could not be given oral steroids. When we had given for the other eye, he had developed femur head necrosis, and he could not tolerate anything else, so we gave him biologics. And with 3 doses, we could protect his right eye. The lesions became inactive. This is another young man who came with the one eye involvement, and even while he was on high dose steroids, we could not save his foveal center from scarring. His skin test was negative, TB gold was negative. It was okay. Now he came a year later with the left eye involvement, and now we put him on high dose steroids, but the lesion continued to increase. We started ATT, though everything was negative, because we had learned that even in cases with negative results, it works, but it didn't work. The lesion was enlarging, and by this time, you see, he had got 11 doses of intravenous methylprednisolone also, 1 gram each day. And then we added periocular steroids, and again, the lesion was enlarging. And we added Azoran to increase the immunosuppression. ATT was already going on, periocular steroids alternating with IV steroids, and the lesion was going on increasing. And this is the other eye. So this is to show that some cases will not respond, they will continue to increase. But because of the treatment, the scarring is fine and he still has 6x6 vision. So I internet searched the word relentless choroiditis, and I found that there is a term called relentless plecoid chorioretinitis, RPC, term by Yanutzi in 2000, and they found exactly the same pictures where it continues to relentlessly progress, thousands of lesions across the fundus. Steroids and immunosuppression help, but central vision gets affected in all cases and should test for TB because sometimes it is a hypersensitivity to TB. This is, a straightforward case, a wet lesion at the choroid and inferior retina showing the on the right side the pictures. So I think it's very straightforward. It's an active TB. This was the lesion, and this was the macular edema. PPD skin test was positive, started ATT, and this regressed within 5 days. This looked like endogenous endophthalmitis, but could also be TB. Considering endogenous endoph, we injected him with intravitreal antibiotics. His skin test was negative, TB gold positive. We gave him intravitreal antibiotics and the oral levoflox, and he resolved. So we thought we had treated endogenous endoph. But a few weeks later, he comes with these multiple lesions in the lower periphery. So now we knew this was TB, which TB also responds to levoflox as well as to intravitreal antibiotics, but only temporarily. So now we started ATT. And even after starting ATT, you can get new lesions for a few weeks. But now you see the beautiful resolution. This is again TB lesion, but not responding to 4-drug ATT because this was a multi-drug resistant TB. So if you have a lesion, you are strongly suspecting TB but not responding, it could be MDR TB. Started 7-drug TB treatment and he responded. Here I would like any guesses on an immunocompromised patient, choroidal lesions, asymptomatic, picked up on screening. So pneumocystis carinii, choroidopathy, which indicates the patient has pneumocystis pneumonia. Here, what would be the diagnosis? Sarcoid choroidal granulomas. This is a relatively young person, came with sudden vision loss, no pain, but headache, severe headache. So the significant history is left eye had had a globe rupture 1.5 months back, which was repaired. So this was sympathetic ophthalmia, and the FFA was characteristic, showing punctate leaks. This is typically, now I'm coming to retinitis, SLE. Very typical of SLE, a young lady or a middle-aged lady presenting with this, responding to steroids. But look for new vessels in the periphery. Very often they can be occult. Again, a disease related to SLE called adult onset Still's disease responds again to very well to steroids. The difference here is you can make the diagnosis from the type of rash. It's a fleeting rash. Within hours, it fleets, changes its location, and high fever. So this was a young man who had this kind of fleeting rash history and sudden vision loss following this fever and fleeting rash. He was placed on intravitreal, not by me, but before me, by somebody with intravitreal ganciclovir, oral vial acyclovir, intravitreal clindamycin for toxo, not responding to anything. But with that history of migratory pink rash, I did consider AOSD, Still's disease. And because he had the fleeting rash also seen in rickettsia, we got a Weil-Felix test done, which was strongly positive. So we gave him the benefit of doubt for both the things. For AOSD, we put him on pulse steroids, and there was a lot of improvement. And then for rickettsia, on doxycycline for 2 weeks. And there was a lot of improvement in his vision from 1/60 to 6/24, which was not happening on 2 months of antivirals and steroids. This is a patient who had a viral fever, and serology positive for herpes zoster. And while the skin rash of herpes was there, she developed these lesions. So here what I'm trying to say is that if you have given antivirals for 6 weeks and there is no improvement, you can go to very high dose IV steroids as well, because optic nerve is also involved. And in this patient, we gave IV steroids, and there was a remarkable improvement of vision to 6/9. As toxo heals, you can develop CNVM at the edge of the lesion, and that requires treatment. This looks like a toxo lesion, but actually the smears showed it was candida. And young lady, endogenous candida infection, not immunocompromised, required 1 year of treatment with intravitreal injections as well as oral with this result. This is CMV retinitis. And this is a deep retinal infection from herpes zoster in an immunocompromised patient, progressive PORN, and this causes blindness invariably. A Okay, the last slides I would like to show is a dengue retinitis, which can present few weeks after the fever, and this is an autoimmune, it's an immune problem, and should be treated with steroids, otherwise it can lead to severe ischemia and causing vitreous hemorrhage as well, and heals with dengue foveolitis, which affects the vision. This is how dengue retinitis and foveolitis look. Thank you.